Chapter 1. Perceiving People. Everyone has their own habits and peculiarities. It's too tiring to be unique every day of your life because there are simply too many responsibilities. Without a schedule, life would be chaos. Over time, certain strategies rise and others fall away. Each will have their own experience with this journey, but there are larger patterns within the human story. Introversion and extroversion are attributes that people are quick to judge in one another. People often perceive themselves as social, or as someone who isn't interested in outings as much as they are in their hobbies. This speaks to natural division within humanity, as people simply have preferences for different things. Some people are introverted, others are extroverted, and most of us are ambiverts. This means that most of us are somewhere in between, displaying both introverted and extroverted qualities. The population of people who are only socially focused and those who are only focused on their own pursuits is incredibly low compared to the people who are a mix. Understanding this, the label introvert and extrovert take on a different meaning. When you mention an extrovert, you don't mean somebody who only exists in a social capacity. You mean an ambivert with an extroverted leaning. This is a distinction that's important to make, because it highlights that a person is not a slave to their type, but an expression of their type. When someone is an introvert that engages in extroverted behavior, that does not mean that they are acting out of character. Most people have the capacity for both introverted and extroverted interaction with the world around them. Almost everybody will have to rely on both introverted and extroverted skills to succeed in life. However, it can be observed that there are massive gaps in the way that people communicate with one another. Some people are prone to rely on empathy. Other people want to rely on the power of their emotions. Even between two emotional people, there are often differences in how those emotions are expressed. Then there are people who prefer to keep things physical, people who are more prone to dialogue. All sorts of people have their own different ways of communicating, but there are common threads between them. Carl Jung described 8 cognitive functions. These functions are introverted thinking, extroverted thinking, introverted feeling, extroverted feeling, introverted sensations, extroverted sensations, introverted intuition, and extroverted intuition. Everyone has each of these individual functions with them, but in a hierarchy. If someone has introverted sensing as their primary function, then introverted intuition is their weakest function. Each of these functions and their placement determines the mechanics of the different archetypes. The placement of the 4 main functions of the personality is the area of focus for this work, as the shadow functions are more important when studying therapy than how to analyze others through a social atmosphere. Each archetype has a primary function, an auxiliary function, a tertiary function, and an inferior function. The placements of these functions are such that the primary and the inferior are opposites, as are the auxiliary and tertiary functions. If an individual has extroverted intuition primary function, then they will have an introverted sensing as inferior function. The functions that dominate conversation mostly come down to introverted feeling, extroverted feeling, introverted thinking, and extroverted thinking. These are the rational functions or judging functions. They are the functions that allow individuals to organize the world around them and to judge the merit of the world themselves. If an individual has introverted feelings as a primary or auxiliary function, then that person has extroverted thinking as a tertiary or inferior function. If they have extroverted feeling as a primary or auxiliary function, then they have introverted thinking as a tertiary or inferior function. The shorthand names used for archetypes should be decoded instead of seen as several binaries. An INFJ isn't an introvert as discussed above. They're ambiverts except for a few select purists. Instead of interpreting an INFJ as an introverted feeler who trusts their intuition, one should read the functions that make up their archetype. All judgers have an extroverted judging function. All perceivers have an extroverted perceiving function. As the INFJ is a judger with feeling for their rational function, their judging function is extroverted feeling. But because they're introverted, it's their auxiliary function. Now, as their rational function is known, their perceiving function needs to be decoded. They're an intuitive archetype and they're introverted. So that means their primary function will be introverted intuition. Once the primary and auxiliary functions are known, it is easy to find the tertiary and inferior functions. The tertiary function is the opposite of the auxiliary function, and the inferior function is the opposite of the primary function. So for the INFJ, this means that their tertiary function is introverted thinking, as their auxiliary function is extroverted feeling. Their inferior function is extroverted sensation, as introverted intuition is their primary function. All of these types can be decoded in this way, and that is what should be understood by the shorthand INFJ. It should not be taken to mean an introverted, intuitive feeling judger, as that does not adequately describe an INFJ. INFJs can be incredibly cold and calculating people who demand on logic over feelings. This is because they have either underdeveloped their extroverted feeling, or they can get caught in a feedback loop between introverted intuition and introverted thinking. Even though their primary extroverted function is a feeling function, that doesn't mean that they have a healthy relationship with it. The binary falls apart because the ways that people utilize their different functions has endless varieties. For another example, INTPs can be utterly opposed to novelty. ENTPs and INTPs are supposed to be hungry for advancement and new ideas due to the pairing of extroverted intuition with introverted thinking. But when an INTP gets scared of the world, they can leave their extroverted intuition underdeveloped while over-relying on introverted sensation. People do not need to act like their archetype to belong to them. This is a system to make sense of humanity, not a code of law. Once this is understood, then basic misconceptions can be done away with, like that thinkers only get along with thinkers, or that feelers only get along with feelers. The important part of the theory is not where someone fits on binary, but how well they balance the abilities that they were given. It is also apparent that maturity does not lead to people who match up on the binary congregating, but that people who have complementary functions do. It's easy for people who have the same pair of rational functions to communicate, as they both perceive the world in similar ways. An INTJ and an ESFP will usually have an easier time getting on the same page than an INTJ and an ISTP. This is because both the INTJ and the ESFP use the same system to take in information, even if they do the steps in different orders. They simply need to relate to their own past experience to understand the other's position. However, between the INTJ and the ISTP, there's a gap of communication, as the ISTP relies on introverted thinking, while the INTJ communicates through extroverted thinking. This also means that the INTJ relies on introverted feeling, while the ISTP relies on extroverted feeling. All of their functions of judgment are incongruent. This doesn't mean that there can't be great communication between an ISTP and an INTJ, but that there is a level of understanding that must be reached. Introverted thinking and extroverted thinking are very different energies. While the ISTP will always want to experiment with things until he masters muscle memory to the point of competency, the INTJ will want proof of a concept's validity before they file it away in their memory. The ISTP relies on physical experience to improve the functionality of the universe around him, while the INTJ prefers to prove his points in the light of the consensus of specialists. However, it's not so simple that only people with the same functions get along. There have been many pairings between INTJs and INTPs who shouldn't be able to be friends considering they have no functions in common. This is because we don't need a clone while interacting with another person, but someone that we can get along with. Every archetype is the exact opposite as the archetype with the same middle two letters and opposite extremes. This means that ESFJs have the exact opposite functions as ISFPs, while the ESFJ's primary function is extroverted feeling. The ISFP's primary function is introverted feeling. The difference between an ESFJ and an ISFJ is only in the placement of their functions, but the difference between an ESFJ and an ESFP is that all of their functions are different, in addition to also being in a different order. While the ESFJ relies on extroverted feeling, the ESFP relies on extroverted sensation. Due to this, the difference between the INTP and the INTJ is not only function that they possess, but the order of those functions. While the INTP grows their understanding of materials endlessly, the INTJ has a vision that is a well of understanding which can't be expressed. This is not a position that puts either archetype at odds. Granted that the INTP is emotionally mature and the INTJ has patience, the relationship is actually incredibly potent because it allows for an incredible amount of information allocation. Provided neither the INTJ nor the INTP gets bogged down by trying to prove themselves or demanding proof from their counterpart, then their relationship can flourish. Both are the most equipped for the pursuit of abstract thought, and through developing a beneficial relationship with each other, they almost completely address their philosophical blind spots. The binary of being thinkers isn't the reason that these two types get along, but through the strength of their communication skills. If both types are mature enough to communicate in a way that doesn't aggravate the other, then there is an incredible relationship to be had. This is because both of them think in entirely different ways from one another. Being flexible enough to get along in every situation is the benefit of understanding the functions and balancing your relationship with them. There is no best archetype, nor is there one that is best at communicating. Interpersonal skills come from maturity and practice, not being born charming. The simplest way to get along with others is to get over yourself. You don't need things to go your way all the time. Learn what others are doing, support them in doing so, and try to take part if you can. The more you can get along with people who are different than you, then the more you will be trained to do so in general. If you can have a great relationship with someone who communicates in a language that might as well be foreign to you, then it will be simple to get along with people who are on the same page as you. Resistance makes the muscles stronger. So approach this understanding from the point of trying to achieve balance. Don't game people to get them to like you, or set up expectations for someone like they're a pet. Know that everyone is unique and that analyzing their archetype is a way for you to learn how you can best communicate with them, but not because you'll gain a secret power or influence over them. Once you are able to use the system like this, it will naturally follow that you are able to read the archetypes of the people that you are exposed to. Develop your relationship with people who are interested in the theory and see how they utilize these functions in their lives. Once you observe any of the functions in one person, your understanding of that function in general grows. No one exists in a vacuum. Everyone is a human in the end. If you can get along with a few people, then you have a good chance of getting along with strangers. If even your closest relationships are strained, then it's time to start analyzing how you communicate. Focus on learning about how people function, not how the archetypes do. Observe the functions being used by the people around you. Grow your understanding of people, not your loyalty to a theory. Ultimately, the important part to cue in is the ineffable experience that humans go through, not to have a checkbook that you can use to judge others. Make sure to be trying to reach a place of empathy, and you'll be guided in the right direction.